chote utataka nitakupama.
The club, one day doing this, one day doing that, one day being able to just do whatever I want and not have to worry about halal and haram. I wish I could do that for one day. And while we're looking out saying that, you have those people that come to Islam that have lived their entire lives without halal and haram and are saying that I never felt alive until the day I said La ilaha illallah Muhammadan Rasulullah. That lived a free lifestyle and did whatever they want and didn't have to worry about anything, in some cases obviously, and then come to Islam and recognize that in that submission the heart is given life. Now why do I mention this? Because a lot of times, the only time we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is when we want something. And that in and of itself is insincere. And sometimes we expect Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to feed our worldly addictions. You see someone who's in the masjid, it could be for something halal. A young man that's in the masjid, all of a sudden, why are you in the masjid? I've got my MCAT coming up. You know, I really want to make sure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts barakah in it. You know, something really, really, really bad happened to me. So that's why I'm coming to Allah. And it's sad because many times when you see someone turning towards religion for the first time in a long time, it's because of one of two things happened. Either somebody died or something really bad happened to them. And then all of a sudden, oh Allah, give me this. Oh Allah, give me that. Oh Allah, give me this. And yes, you know what? Sometimes that is the moment that changes your life. Sometimes that is the moment that turns everything around for you. But your relationship with Allah cannot just stop at that. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives it to you, فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَّمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا. As for the human being, as for man, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him by giving him the good of this world, فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا. He would say, my Lord has honored me. Not in a way of praise, but in a way of boasting. Meaning I don't have to worry about anything else I'm doing in my life. Allah clearly loves me because Allah is giving me. وَأَمَّا إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ فَقَدَرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقًا. That same person, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him and restricts his wealth a little bit, Allah just takes a little bit of it away, and Allah puts him in a little bit of a hard situation. My life is over. قَالَ رَبِّ أَهَانًا. Why is Allah doing this to me? Why is God doing this to me? Because why should Allah feed your dunya addictions? That would be no different than finding someone who's addicted to a drug, something that's not real. And instead of stopping him from his addiction, saying, no, I want you to feel good about yourself, go ahead and take it. Allah breaks us off from those addictions. Allah breaks us off from those things so that we can understand what really gives us life. And you know what's amazing about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, above all, above many other things, is that when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to Hira at the age of 40 to contemplate, to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to seek meaning in this life, did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have any marital issues? Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have any economic problems? Was he broke sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam suffering from any lack of reputation? No, he was a sadiq al-amin. He was the honest, the trustworthy one. Did anything happen to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to send him up to that mountain? No. There were no strings attached. He didn't go to Allah for a spiritual high. He went to Allah to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to revive his heart sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was already alive sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But to adorn it with this beautiful revelation, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with the true understanding and implementation of La ilaha illallah Muhammadan Rasulullah, and to forgive us for our shortcomings, and to forgive us when we look to other than Him for satisfaction and tranquility. Allahumma ameen. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullahi wa lakum wa li sa'ir al-muslimin fastaghfiru innahu huwal ghafur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين والعاقبة للمتقين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على عبدك ورسولك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. Dear brothers, please move forward as much as you can. Dear brothers and sisters, in conclusion of this khutbah, when we talk about reviving our hearts and why we feel low, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to turn to Him with no strings attached. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends you moments. And Allah azza wa jalla says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِ لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ وَمَا نَزَلَ مِنَ الْحَقِّ. Isn't it time for those who believe to soften their hearts to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that which He has revealed from the truth? You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends us many moments. And I ask everyone this question. How many times did you have a near-death experience where it would have just been a split, if it would have been just a little bit different, just a split second further and your car would have crashed and you would have been dead? You were so close to death. Or you face some sort of tragedy, some sort of financial tragedy, or something happened in your life that shook you. How many times did that happen to you? Allah was sending you a wake-up call. And if you go back to sleep, Allah just sends you a louder wake-up call. And the wake-up calls will keep getting louder and louder and louder and louder. Because you can't just get up and say, I'm awake, and then go back to sleep. You have to get up and start moving. And put yourself in an environment, and put yourself in a submission, so that the heart that was dead can now thrive. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَطَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدْ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. You know what happens whenever you let a time pass? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't be like those people who let time pass between that wake-up call and between their submission. Time passed and they forgot how they felt when they lost that person. They forgot how they felt when they were down. طَالَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْأَمَدْ فَقَسَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ. And so their hearts became hard. They became harder. وَكَثِيرٌ مِّنْهُمْ فَاسِقُونَ. And many of those people are wicked transgressors. Dear brothers and sisters, when we look at the lives of the Sahaba, many times it was that extreme wake-up call that brought them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But you know what? Their relationship with Allah didn't stop there. It was the catalyst. It was the catalyst. Because when Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu goes to his sister's home and he recites those few verses of Surah Taha, Umar radiallahu anhu, when he's awake, goes straight to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and puts his heart now in an environment where it can thrive. Within 24 hours, the same man that was out to kill the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is standing out there and defending the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he understood that I have to change my ways now. I'm not going to go home and think about this and say, you know what, maybe I'll get religious later on and maybe I should. No, I know the way that I felt when I recited those few verses of Surah Taha. What I understood and what Allah was trying to tell me, I can't shut my eyes after this, or else the next time the wake-up call is going to get louder and louder and louder. And that's why when we talk about reviving the heart, every time the Prophet ﷺ talked about the heart, and he said it was named the heart, al-qalb, because tataqallab, it constantly changes. And the Prophet ﷺ described it as a feather that would keep on turning over and over and over with the wind. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's most frequent dua was, Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. O turner of hearts, make my heart firm on your deen. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us that in order to settle that very fragile heart which turns over like a leaf in the desert or a feather in the desert, you have to create the right wind. You have to put it in an environment where it thrives, in an environment where Allah is mentioned, around people that mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and take it off of all of those things, or remove it and detach it from all of those things that cause it to harden and cause it to die. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when we turn to Him with our hearts, we don't just turn to Him because we want something of this world, but we turn to Him seeking His pleasure. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our hearts firm on His path. Ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qulubuna ala deenik. O turner of hearts, make our hearts firm on your deen. Allahumma ighfir lil-mu'minin wal-mu'minat wal-muslimin wal-muslimat al-ahya'i minhum wal-amwat innaka sami'un qareebun mujibu da'wat. Allahumma ighfir lana warhamna wa'afu anna wa la tu'adhibna. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa in lam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna min al-khasirin. Allahumma innaka 'afuwun tuhibbul 'afwa fa'fu 'anna. Allahumma ighfir li walidina rabbi irhamhuma kama ربنا صغارا. ربنا هب لنا من أزواجنا وذرياتنا قرة أعين واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم انصر المستضعفين
في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم أصلح أحوال إخواننا المنكوبين في مشارق الأرض ومغاربها. اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين. اللهم أهلك الظالمين بالظالمين وأخرجنا وإخواننا من بينهم سالمين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. فاذكروا الله يذكركم واشكروه على نعمة يزد لكم ولذكر الله أكبر. والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقيم الصلاة.
In short, let's choose God over worldly things and we're bound to have a better life. Let's also surround ourselves with friends that actually encourage us to draw closer to God than us being involved in worldly things. At the end of the day, we become what we involve ourselves in. We become what we read, we become what we eat. So if we're eating things that don't aid our body, we become just something else. If we read bad stuff, we become those bad things. If we listen to bad stuff, we become those bad stuff we're intaking. And yeah, so at the end of the day, choose God over anything. It doesn't matter what, always remember to choose God first. It shouldn't even be a matter of, but this, let me do this first, that's when I'll pray later or look into God later. It should never ever be like that. Let me know what you guys think about this video. A thumbs up to the person that suggested this. Make sure to give this video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and of course do not forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in my next reaction video.